So we have been discussing Gita, and in the third chapter, today we take up verse number 33 and 34. These two are conjoined, these two go together, verse number 33 and 34. These two verses are very, very, very interesting verses and deal a lot with practical situation in life. It talks about the great impediment, the great obstacle in life. Why we can't grow? Why we are not happy? Why we are always suffering? Why we are a failure? All these things they are discussing just in two verses. No, that's the beauty of Gita, that Gita discusses very serious problems in just one or two verses. It's phenomenal that a book can discuss such serious issues, such grave issues, just in one or two verses. It says that, look, Shri Krishna is telling Arjuna, sadvisham cheshtate sasya prakritir gyanvan api prakritim yanti bhutani nigra kim karishyati. Look, every person in this world, every object in this world, everything in this world is badly tied down by his nature or her nature. There is that nature, and that nature has tied that person down and that object down. So when there is a piece of stone, it is tied down by its nature. When there is water, it is tied down by its nature. So water has a tendency to flow down, and same water, when it becomes vapor, it rises up. The same thing, as water particle goes down, as vapor particle goes up, they are all tied down by their nature. What is true of the physical universe is true of us too, but not fully, of course. Says sadrisam cheshtate swasya. People are continuously struggling. Everybody wants to be successful. Everybody wants to be happy. Everybody wants to be great. And yet people don't succeed. Why exactly they don't succeed? Gita says, how can they succeed? They're so badly tied on with their own nature. And what is nature? Acharya Shankar very beautifully explains, prakriti naam purva krita dharma dharma adharma adhi sanskara vartaman janmado abhivyakta sa prakriti. What is prakriti says? Whatever you have been doing, birth after birth, you have been living this life, birth after birth, and there you have done many kinds of acts. You can see how we are running our life. We have been doing thousands of things every day, and all these acts are producing good and bad. What by good and bad we mean? Their respective impressions in our mind. And today we are a bundle, a complete package. Package is a very small word, very, very small word. There is a complete storehouse within our mind of our sanskar. Sanskar basically means subtle impressions. The way, you know, in any computer, you have those programs written, and there are millions and millions, and they say, earlier it used to be kilobyte, now then there was MB and then GB, and now we have tetrabyte of information. It's phenomenal in such a small disk, and now you have pen drives, such a small thing, and it contains so much of information. Just like that, our brain, it contains, tetrabyte is a very small term, starting creation, and God knows when that creation took place, everything that you have done, not the memories, but the subtle impressions, they are there. And you know, those impressions are just like, you know, those of you who understand computer will understand, you will understand it very well. Your program is running beautifully, and somebody has put a virus, or you yourself have put a timer, that on such and such date, at such and such time, this will come up and it will shut down the computer. You are working fine. Like yesterday I was working on my computer, and suddenly I found there is something like Chromium something, some, it's a nuisance, some kind of browser. It has entered. Somehow it had entered, we don't know. And it was not letting me do anything. You don't let me work on internet, neither on my computer. Anyway, the experts came and cleared it. Sanskara are just like that. You are running your life well, and suddenly there is one impression. It's just waiting. It's waiting for the right opportunity. Like you have, in other times there used to be robbers and all hiding behind some tree. And the moment a lonely traveler was crossing, they would pounce upon them. If you look at some good pond where there are lots of fish, you'll see that there are herons and other birds. They're just sitting, and the moment there is a movement, it will pounce and catch the fish. So there are these impressions, all kinds, good and bad, neutral. You are doing something bad, and suddenly some good sanskar, it pops up, and it tells you should not be doing this. You are doing something good, and suddenly some bad sanskara pops up. See, all these good things are all nonsense. Let's go enjoy the world. Prakriti means the sum total of all the impressions that you have been carrying from all your previous births. So you are hopelessly tied. In what way? We don't know. Like we have a combination of good and bad. We have a complete storehouse of all the good and bad. Even when you want to do something, you are being goaded, you are being forced into doing that by your sanskara. And no wonder people go on talking about free will and God's will. And we have discussed free will and God's will quite a few times, and we are not getting into it. Let's take our identity purely as physical and mental. We are not getting into that nature of soul. We are not getting into that Atman. We are not getting into Vedanta. We are talking about me as the person who is body, mind, ego complex. Let's assume that I am that body, mind, ego complex. Now what happens? My mind is full of impressions. And those subtle impressions known as sanskara, all the things that I have done, good, bad, neutral, whatever it is, it's all there. And whenever there is a situation, these sanskaras, they immediately pop up and say, it belongs to me. You know, we Hindus, we have gone to that far that it says that if you really love eating meat a lot, and you can't live without eating meat, maybe in the next birth you will be born as a lion and keep eating meat, or maybe you might even be born as a vulture and go on eating carrion and enjoy it. Because human body is not really fit to enjoy meat to that level. For that you need a lion body. You'll be born as a lion. And then you realize that you don't want it. Then again, there are other sanskaras. It will make you a bird, and it will make you some other animal, and it will make a human being. And then they're continuously pushing you, forcing you. There's no way, there's no independence. And that's why we keep on talking about that. As far as human beings are concerned, there is absolutely no free will, no independence, because free will belongs only to Atman. And when you are identifying yourself with body, mind and ego, there is no free will. Okay, if there is no free will, if I am continuously being forced by my past impressions, by my past, if my past is forcing me to do things, if my present is the product of my past and my future will be the product of this present, then why should I go to any spiritual teacher? And why should I be reading Gita? And why should I be reading scriptures? Why should I be doing good things? And how can Gita or any religious book help somebody who is predetermined? If you say that my life is predetermined, by what? By my past. The impelling forces are already there, and you know what its outcome is going to be. So of what use is these books? Even if somebody tries to intervene, can that person really help you? Is it possible? No, cannot help you. That is what it appears. Actually, nobody can help. You might have seen, there is a baby, it's crying. So supposing there is a kid who is 4 years, 5 years old, and he sets his mind on something. Try reasoning with that person, you can do nothing about it. He will have his way. One kid sometime comes to me, is maybe 2 years old, and whenever he comes, first thing he does, he opens my drawer and takes out all the pen and takes all the paper and starts making, starts drawing things. And he also gets down to painting the floor with those pens. The moment I try to take a pen out, the way he starts screaming and shedding tears, and if somebody sees, will think that I have been beating him, I have been trying to butcher him like that. I give him back that pen, and in an instant all his tears vanish. He is again smiling. You just can't reason with kids. It's just not possible. And what about grown-ups? Same thing. You can't reason with any grown-up. Grown-ups listen to you out of politeness. They will do what they have decided to do. When somebody comes to you for some suggestions, some advice, basically they want this stamp of approval from you, because when things go wrong in future, they want you to be blamed, to be there to be blamed. I personally have suffered it so many times. Someone will come and ask for something, I'll say, okay, go do. Things will go wrong, and then they will come and say, see, you had also told. Arey, what do you mean by I had also told? If you tell that person, otherwise he's not going to listen to you. He says, see, whenever I come to you, always say negative. And if you say what he wants, in future he will say that you had also supported me. That's the big problem. Actually, it happens like that. So what is the way out? What is the way out of suffering? Says, Indriyasyendriyasyarthe raga dvesho vyavasthito tayona vasama agacche to yasya paripanthino. Says, paripanthi. Paripanthi means like the robbers, the waylayers, those who waylay your path. In earlier times, the population was not so much, security was not so much. Whenever there were travelers, there would be different kinds of robbers and thieves. They would just waylay you, take the things away and kill you. Says, our sense organs, indriya, they keep on moving towards their respective objects. So the eyes are there, the eyes want to see beautiful sights. Ear, they want to hear beautiful sound, loving sound. Similarly with nose and taste buds, and the skin. Skin wants soft touch, the loving touch. Whenever it gets those five things, it instructs the mind, or it forces the mind to act accordingly, and gets the five organs of action into the field. So five sense organs and five organs of action we call Jnanendriya and Karmendriya. Jnanendriya collect, Karmendriya act. Or you can say that the world acts on us through the five sense organs and makes us react through five organs of action. It is their own prerogative. The senses keep on moving towards their respective objects. And when they are moving, there are two great robbers. They are raga and dvesha. Raga means love for what you like. Dvesha means dislike for what you don't like. There is raga and there is dvesha. Whenever there is an act, every time there is an act by you, and whenever the world acts on you, so whether it be action or be reaction, you will see that there is never a neutral reaction. It's always raga, dvesha. You love certain things, you hate certain things. Our life moves continuously between love and hate. When favorable things come, we love. When unfavorable things come, we hate. So the technical term in Sanskrit for these are rag and dvesh. Says that rag and dvesh, these are the two great robbers who are always there to waylay. They are there to hijack the entire system. Now people who are wise, or people who are living with the wise, people who are reading scriptures, people who follow a religious path, what they do is, they know that there is no freedom, there is no way that you can escape a situation because your past is pushing you. So what is the way out? Just note where there is going to be rag and dvesha, where there is going to be lustings and hatred, where you are going to feel attracted, where you are going to feel repelled. Stay away from that. Stay away from that. How do you stay away? Your organs can't stay away. What your mind can do is, mind is slightly superior to the senses. And if you stay in the company of noble people, good people, sagely people, saintly people, and if you are continuously studying good books, that includes religious texts, slowly it makes your mind powerful enough to stay away just from two things. Whenever you know that there is going to be some attraction or there is going to be some repulsion, you say that don't go near it, don't go near it. But if you go near it, nothing can save you. Your body cannot save you, your senses can't save you, your mind can't save you, your guru can't save you, your God can't save you, nobody can save you. Okay, let us give an example. Thakur Sri Ramakrishna used to say that in the pond there are lots of fish, fishermen come, throw the net. Now you have four kinds of fish. The first kind of fish is who are thoroughly caught and they think that they are safe, they are okay, and they try to pull the net further down thinking that they can save themselves without knowing that fisherman is going to catch them and they are going to die. The second lot of fish, they are struggling to come out. They know that they are trapped. They struggle but they can't come out. They just can't. Their situation is worse. Third, rarest of rare, there are some experts who can jump out of it. They are the great ones who can jump out. And the fourth one, the real masters, they never hover anywhere near the net. But that's about, Sri Ramakrishna is talking about the great scheme of Maya. Here we are talking of at a much smaller level. There is rag and dvesh. Imagine there is some kind of dance bar. Just imagine, it's a crude example. If you enter the dance bar, you can go on enjoying, and you know that you can't come out of it. Then there would be somebody who realizes that he has to come out of it. Even if he struggles, he can't come out. Maybe rarest of rare may come out. That's rarest of rare. So what is the best option? Don't go near it. Just don't go near it. If you go near it, for example, when it comes to drugs, drug addiction. Once you are a drug addict, you are finished. But what happens, the example of drug is not really correct here in the sense that your folks can realize it and can take you to rehabilitation center, etc. Here, there is nobody who can help because your mind is playing that ultimate thing. Nobody can stop you, and if they succeed in stopping you once, they will not be able to stop you a second time. The only power that can save you from this is your own mind, which has become strong enough, powerful enough, through the words of teacher and through the words of scriptures. Your mind knows that, okay, that is a place where there is going to be attraction, and there is a place where there is going to be repulsion. Let me not run away from this repulsive thing, and let me not move towards this lustful thing. Because once I go near things that repel me, I am going to react violently. And things that attract me, that's going to trap me. So what is the way out? How to mold character? How to build the power of mind? Actually, there is no way to build. Absolutely, there is no way to build. That's what verse number 33 says. Sadrisham cheshtate swasya. Everybody is struggling. Everybody is struggling to get power. There are so many books on power of positive thinking. Why nobody is succeeding? Because it's not possible. Why? Because you are just telling, do this, do this, do this. Nobody can do those things. See, have you ever come across any student who doesn't want to be successful, who doesn't want to be a topper in the class? But he can't. Even if he struggles, he can't. Similarly, no one wants to be bad. When people become bad, it's purely out of helplessness. And once they become bad, they do not want their children to be bad. And yet things go wrong. Everybody is struggling for success and struggling to rise above things. They can't. What is the way out? That way out is suggested in verse number 34. Once you know that this thing is going to tempt you, stay away from that. Don't go near it. Because if you go near it, you are bound to be tempted. There is a person, supposing he is an alcoholic, assuming that alcoholism is not a good thing. And if he hears enough, if he is concerned about his family, if he is concerned about his well-being, and he realizes that I should be drinking, what is the best way out? Just stay away from alcohol. Don't go anywhere near the place where alcohol is being sold. Don't keep a single bottle of alcohol for emergency. Stay away. Stay away, particularly from raga dvesha. Wherever there is, you know that this thing has an attraction for you, this thing has a repulsion for you. So there will be violence wherever there is repulsion. And once you are into it, there is no way that you can come out of it. Once you get down to drinking, there is no way. You can't say that I will have one peg and after that I will stop. No, you won't. Nobody can succeed. Your tendencies, your past sanskaras will push you towards that. Stay away. So, says that ultimately it is attachment and aversion, the desire to avoid, the desire to seek, that forces people to do acts. Control that. There is just no way that you can control your acts. But at a higher level, those desires can, you can try to stay away from those desires. Stay away, that's the only way. And as you grow more powerful, as you keep on practicing this control of aversion and attachment more and more, you grow in power. As you grow in power, you can control more and more. And then a time may come when you can have control, complete control over acts. You know, there is that famous story about Socrates. Socrates was a learned person and he had complete control over himself, and he hated people who didn't have control over themselves. So there is that description that one day, and Socrates loved to talk. So once there was a party, he went to that party and they were having drinks, and Socrates was having drinks, and he was talking, as usual, he was talking and talking and talking, and he was talking more. And slowly it was midnight, and it was one, and then two, and the guests, they slowly started dropping to sleep. They were drunk. And Socrates went on talking. Then hardly three or four people remained, and then two, and then one. And finally, that person also fell off to sleep. Socrates took this last peg. By then it was dawn. It was early morning. Socrates walked out, went to the marketplace, and he started talking there. And somebody who had slept early, he came out and saw that. Socrates, who had talked whole night and drinking, nothing affected him. He was completely calm. He has reached that level where wine can't touch him. We people, we are ordinary mortals. We are not like him. So the only option for us is, you stay away from that. If you don't stay away, you won't be able to stop. And once a person can't stop, once a person is under the sway, complete sway of raga dvesha, things can really go bad for him, which is described in famous verse of 35, Shreyan Swadharmo Viguna Pardharmat Swanustitat Swadharme Nidhanam Shreya Pardharmo Bhayavaha. It is better to die in your own dharma than to take up the dharma of others. Before we continue with this, let's again go back to verse number 33 and 34 just for a moment. But verse number 33 and 34 are ultimately secret of willpower. How to increase your willpower? You can't increase your willpower through acts. Most things that you will read, most things when you read books on positive thinking, books on personality building, books on this and books on that, you will see that they will suggest you to do this, do that. But according to Gita, the only way to increasing willpower is staying away from attachments and aversion. Because if you don't, then a time will come when you will be a mental wreck. And once you are a mental wreck, you will even give up your Swadharma. In these times, many people have been describing Swadharma as Hindu Dharma and Islam Dharma and Christianity Dharma. No, here it does not mean that. Swadharma is a technical word. Swadharma is a technical word which actually, according to Gita, Swadharma is a very, very, very important concept. In fact, we Hindus, we put a lot of stress on Swadharma. Now, earlier we had once discussed Swadharma. Let's discuss it in very brief. Swadharma means way of life, your way of life. And Swadharma means the duties and responsibilities that you have accepted. Simplest explanation of Swadharma is what makes you. Dharma is normally translated as religion, but dharma means your nature. Dharma means what you are, that which holds you, that which you are. So you are what? You are what your duties and responsibilities make you. Once you have accepted duty and responsibility, you must stay true to it. Why? Now, at this point, Hindu religion gets into a very elaborate explanation of what forms duties, what forms responsibilities. In brief, if a person goes all out for God, all out for self-realization, he has no duty whatsoever. Provided he goes all out for God, the way sages used to go, the way monks, sannyasis used to go. Now, if a person doesn't go all out for God, then of course he is living in the world. And Gita, and for that matter Hindu religion, is an inclusive religion. By being inclusive religion, it means that we accept Vedanta to be the truth. And according to truth, Vedantic truth, God alone exists. And that level of being one with God is inclusiveness. When you come down from that level, it is humanity. Because humanity is a larger inclusive whole. Come down from there, your country becomes a little less. From there, your locality. From there, your family. And finally, you yourself. Duty comprises your responsibility towards all this. In between, just before you go to country and after country somewhere, sometimes, you know, different our sages have placed your occupation somewhere in between. Now, your duty towards humanity, to serve humanity, to help humanity is prime because it's higher. Your country is further higher. Occupation, because it's giving you money so that you can serve your locality, your family and yourself. It's very important. And then locality and family and yourself. In the descending order of inclusiveness, you need to put priority on the higher things. Whenever there is a conflict of interest between, say, your own country and your occupation, it is your duty to pay attention to the country's interest because country is more inclusive. Well, that's how it was defined. Now, Swadharma is a path of least action, least resistance, path of least resistance that you take to make your personality grow. The goal of life is to become inclusive. How do you become inclusive? You control your self-interest, then you control the interest of the family for locality and locality for the country and country's interest for humanity as such. That's why you will see that all the acts that great countries do is they look at the interest of the humanity first and then at the interest of their country. Not that it has to be compromised fully, but in general. So Swadharma means, the highest Swadharma is to go all out for God, forgetting everything else. If not humanity, your country, your occupation, your locality, your family and yourself. Now supposing there is, you get one apple from somewhere. You come to your family. Who should get it? Your family. That's what will make you inclusive. So Swadharma essentially means your personality, which is a complete existence through the process of sacrifice in the form of humanity, nation, occupation, locality, family and yourself. And your own existence, that is your own being, your thoughts, your acts, all these three must be at the same frequency. Your life, your words, your thoughts, your acts, they all must be in consonance. There should be a complete resonance. There should not be any kind of discordance. This is Swadharma. So once you have promised to yourself and once you have promised to others that you are going to do this and you have made that your way of life, you must not give up your way of life for any other way of life. Because the moment you give up your way of life for some other way of life, it means that rag and dvesh are involved. Either it is something you hate in your way of life and hence you want other, or you find something attractive, more attractive in the other form of life, that's why you want it. So changing your way of life, changing your Swadharma is the worst possible sin that one can face in life. Let's take the example of, maybe a crude example, but I'm sure you will understand. There is a policeman on duty. And that policeman, he encounters somebody, some thief. What he should be doing? Just think, his dharma, his swadharma says, he should catch hold of that man and put him behind bars. Now supposing that thief says that, okay fine, I stole it because my children are hungry, I need to save them. What is the dharma of a policeman say at this point? Says that the highest dharma is humanity. Don't go by your occupation. Let there be a problem, it does not matter. But generally what we do is, we say that, okay, give me this much of money and I'll release you. Now when the moment you say, okay, give me money and I'll release you, you have taken paradharma. How? The work, this is extortion, some kind of extortion. This is some kind of stealing. This is the job of the thieves. The thieves are there. And if you think that it is some kind of tax, that's the job of the government, not yours. You have given up Swadharma and you have taken up the dharma of somebody else. And you know, in Indian tradition, Chorya Dharma, there are people who are established in the dharma of stealing. That is, there are people who do only that. You cannot do that. Here is a sannyasi and he wants to indulge in things that only a householder can do, enjoying life. So the sannyasi, he has taken up the vows to stay pure, stay dedicated, stay committed, stay in renunciation. He is giving up his dharma and taking up the dharma of grihastha. He wants to enjoy life. Now see, if a person makes some compromise, one can understand, okay fine, he made a compromise, now he performs some penances and he goes back to the pristine pure stage. But giving it up completely, it's a recipe for disaster. Why? It only shows that you are giving up your way of life out of rag and dvesh. You are lustful basically. You are lustful. You see, if children behave that way, if children don't study and go for games, one can understand. But if a college student who is supposed to study, he doesn't study and he is always engaged in games and he is chasing girls and like, he is giving up that dharma. A student, college student, he is supposed to study. He is not supposed to indulge in politics. Politics is not meant for him. So when we hear, you know, like in colleges and universities, there are students going for agitation for this and for that. It's not good. Then we say that, well, they need to be taught everything. No, no. There's a time and place for everything. Your Swadharma, while in college and universities, only to study. Once you become a grihastha, then you will be doing all those things. Then you do. Don't change your profession. Not profession, your Swadharma. What Gita says that, if a person gives up his Swadharma and takes up Paradharma, this is going to lead him to destruction. Why? Because the impelling force behind taking up other dharma is always attachment or aversion. Aversion for what you have been doing and attachment for something that you want, that you are going to take up. Now there have been cases, like in Mahabharata itself we find persons like Dronacharya, they did not hold on to Brahmin's dharma and they took up the Kshatriya dharma. There have been such cases, but in general it said that this life is a great chance where you keep on performing duty so that you improve your future. So that slowly you are evolving. You keep on evolving and you get more power to go further till you become one with God. The moment you come under the sway of attachment and aversion, you have lost that chance. But see, these are general observations. There are occasions when people do make compromise and we find that they have become successful, but scriptures, they do not discuss specific things, they discuss general things. To discuss very specific cases, one has to go to a spiritual teacher. Now what Gita here is discussing, karma yoga. If you really want to attain God through action, through karma, then you don't have to change your dharma. If your goal is something different, do whatever you feel like. But don't say that you are a karma yogi. A karma yogi will never bother about what kind of work he is doing. Because at that level, at the level of karma yogi, what you do is not important. how you do is important. In the world, how you do is not important, what you do is important. But here we are not discussing only the world, we are discussing the larger world. Just try to do things the way one should do, one karma yogi should do, and you will see that all strength is flowing within you, all power is flowing within you. We think that if I can do things that I love, I will be great. No, it's not that. You can be great by doing anything you are doing, provided you can do it consistently for a very long time, totally committed and totally detached. This is Karma Yoga, and this is also the way to success in the world. So here we stay where we end, and next day we take up verse number 36 onwards. Om Shanti Shanti.